Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today I am going to take my lecture on the connective tissue tumors. Or basically, this lecture is from Rook, but you can say that this is also a dermatopathology lecture because, as you all know, that a main issue in all these connective tissue tumors is their histological diagnosis. Clinically, most of them will look like soft to firm to hard nodule or papule. So, on the basis of clinical examination, it is not possible to diagnose most of these connective tissue tumors. And the final diagnosis of these tumors will rest on the histological finding. So that's why today's lecture and the next lecture, which will also be on the same topic, will be a combination of text from Rook and dermatopathology. So let's start. First of all, those tumors which arise from the subcutaneous fat. We discussed a lot about the paniculitis and subcutaneous fat. So you all know where the fat is located and what is the general anatomy of the subcutaneous fat. The most commonest soft tissue tumor which we come across is a lipoma. It is frequent in obese and in middle age. It's a benign tumor. Once removed, its recurrence is uncommon. And progression to liposarcoma is almost never occurs. So chances of getting malignant is not there. That is why you can easily tell to your patients that you may leave the lipoma unremoved unless it is at such a place where it is causing obstructive symptoms. So histologically, the low power view will show a circumscribed and encapsulated, a circumscribed and a capsule tumor comprising of a univaculated mature adipocyte. Adipocytes in lipoma, they contain a single large vacuole because of which the nucleus is pushed to one side of the cell wall. This is called as univaculated adipocyte. The lobules are divided by delicate fibrous septa containing thin walled vessel. Whoever has performed surgery on lipoma, he or she would have noticed that a lipoma is always covered by a capsule. It is deep into the skin and covered by a capsule. And a tip in spotting of lipoma is that usually in the biopsies which are sent for lipoma, we cut the skin and we extract the lipoma. We does not send epidermis and dermis along with the lipoma. So in the histology, you will only see mature adipocyte. There will not be any epidermis or dermis in generally the slides which you will come across in exam or in your clinical practice. Post-traumatic fat necrosis. I have discussed this kind of pathology in paniculitis. These are the lipid-laden xanthoma cells. These are the fat cells which contain lipid, and it is seen in usually post-traumatic fat necrosis. There is a condition which is called as fibrolipoma. Fibrolipoma will be different clinically from lipoma in that it would not be as soft as a normal lipoma. This tumor will be in a form of a nodule, just like a lipoma, skin color nodule, but it will have a firm consistency, not a soft consistency. And histologically, the fibrous component of lipoma will be prominent. There will be fibrous septa along with fat lobules. These are the fibrous septa, collagen. So this is, as the name signifies, it's a fibrolipoma. So it's a combination of fat and fibrous tissue. Then there is another tumor which is called as angiolipoma. And angiolipoma is the A in England, which means, which we use, an acronym which we use for painful tumor. So angiolipoma is one of the painful tumors of the skin. As the name signifies, this tumor comprises of mature adipocytes and blood vessels. And these are the proliferating blood vessels which are seen in the septa, but these vessels, they are prominent. And in clinically, it will the normal size is upper arm, present as a tender and painful papule or a nodule, reddish or bluish discoloration to the skin. One, because there is vascular proliferation, so the tumor will be having some vascular color, that is either red or a bluish color. So clinically, it will give appearance of a nodule on the skin that is tender and painful, and it is of erythematous or bluish color and of soft in consistency. Lipoblastoma will be histologically diagnosed. It is a counterpart of lipoma in infancy. It is seen before 3 years. These are the lipoblasts. You can see these are the mature adipocytes in which there is a univaculated the fat is in univaculated form, while in lipoblastoma there are multiple fat vacuoles. You can see this is a lipoblastoma, this is a lipoblastoma. You can see that within the cell wall there are multiple small vacuoles. So these are the lipoblasts. So the tumor, which comprises of predominantly lipoblast, this is a lipoblast, is called as the lipoblastoma. And this is a benign tumor that would be seen in children less than 3 years of age, infant and children less than 3 years of age. Hibernoma is another form of fat cell tumor. It's a benign tumor that resembles the normal brown fat that occur in young, particularly female. The brown fat in children is mainly on the back of the chest and back of the abdomen. This is the common site of brown fat. There is admixture of mature adipocytes and large cells with eosinophilic and granular cytoplasm. This is an eosinophilic and granular cytoplasm. You know, the brown fat are used for maintaining of body temperature. Okay, so this is an hibernoma. Here you can see the fat cells with granular cytoplasm. Atypical lipomatous tumor or well-differentiated liposarcoma. The key differentiating feature of a liposarcoma is irregularity in size of adipocytes. First of all, you can see in mature lipoma, all the adipocytes are of same size. But now you can see that some are large, some are small. This is the first and most significant histological appearance of an atypical lipoma or well-differentiated liposarcoma. And you can see here, there is multi-vaculated lipoblast, which is the nucleus is rather being on the periphery, it is within the center of the lipoblast. And this nuclear pleomorphism is also a feature of lipo sarcoma, especially when it is poorly differentiated liposarcoma, then nuclei will be of bizarre shape. But irregularity in size of adipocytes, and adipocytes contain multivacuolated cells, then irregularity in the structure of nuclei, especially centrally located nuclei. And you can see this nucleus is scalloped by the fat lobule. Another common tumor, benign tumor, which we come across is nevus lipomatous superficialis. This would come in the differential diagnosis of skin tag and neurofibroma. It is a soft pedunculated mass. They can be multiple, and extensively involvement will result in a typical appearance of Michelin tire baby. Histological feature is the presence of mature adipocytes within the dermis. So dermis is almost completely infiltrated by mature adipocytes. And because of the presence of mature adipocytes in the dermis, the adnexal structures will be absent or reduced in number. Adnexal structures means hair follicles and sweat coils. So now we will be discussing those tumors which have origin from the fibrous tissue. Acrocordon or skin tag, as I told you just before, in the differential diagnosis of nevus lipomatosis, this is again a soft and pedunculated mass, can occur anywhere on the body, and is a very common finding. Once you send this mass for histopathology, it would be there will be two important features. There will be a squamous epithelium, the stratified squamous epithelium of the epidermis, and in the core there will be a normal looking dermis, loose fibrovascular tissue in the dermis. And if you cut it sagittally, then you can see this typical polypoid nature. The skin is folded. The epidermis is of normal thickness. The dermis is also normal with loose fibrovascular tissue and having blood vessels and sweat coils. So this is histology of polyp. Then hypertrophic scar. Hypertrophic scar is it is less raised, and it is usually restricted to the site of injury or operation. It does not extend beyond the boundaries of initiating injury. Histologically, the epidermis will be thinned out because of the stretching involved due to the increase in fibrous tissue. This increased fibrous tissue would stretch the overlying epidermis. That's why the epidermis will be flattened without reti ridges. It will be a nodular fibrous growth. There will be the collagen bundles will be thick and dense collagenous bundles. They will be haphazardly arranged, but they are well composed and tight kind of morphology of these collagenous bundles. Otherwise, there will be no ATPR of the cells. Cells will be fibroblast having spindle or tapering edges. This is a keloid. We come across this every day in our OPDs. The difference between a keloid and a hypertrophic scar is that the keloid would spread beyond the original injury or operation. It would not only spread centrifugally, but will also be heaped up. That is, the lesion will be becoming thicker and thicker. Will be raised from the surface, and this growth continues. If it is unchecked, then the keloids may reach to a very large sizes. Histologically, the keloid and hypertrophic scars, they are similar to each other. But the little difference is the collagen bundles were actually thicker in hypertrophic scar as well. But in keloid, these collagen bundles, they are hyalinized. They are more pinkish and having a hyalinized structure. And these are the mature fibroblasts with typically tapering edges, tapering nuclei, spindle-shaped nuclei. So the difference between a hypertrophic scar and keloid is, here the collagen bundles are thickened and compact, and here the collagen bundles are again compact, but they are more hyalinized, more pinkish in color. Otherwise, if you call a keloid a scar or a scar a keloid, it is not a big difference. The next tumor is a nodular fasciitis. It is a florid, reactive, proliferative growth of myofibroblasts, not only fibroblasts, but myofibroblasts and fibroblasts in young age over limbs and face. A rapid growth and is usually painful. This nodular fasciitis is a well-circumscribed fibrous tissue proliferation. And here in this, there is much more irregular border, but this plump fibroblasts are obvious here. Plump spindle cells, spindle-shaped fibroblasts are seen here. This is not in a typical rush mat pattern, but you can see individual fascicles and nests of these spindle-shaped cells. But this is a well-localized growth. And there are areas of myxoid, means mucinous deposition, and hemorrhages in nodular fasciitis. Nodular fasciitis clinically looks like a well-circumscribed painful nodule on the limbs and the face. So it has a firmer consistency, and if you do histopathology, there will be a well-localized fibrous tissue proliferation comprising of plump spindle-shaped cells. Knuckle pads, very common observation you can see in laborers and in manual workers. These are thickened plaques over the interphalangeal and metacarpophalangeal joints, otherwise asymptomatic. Histologically, there will be thick hyperkeratosis. This is lamina statum corneum, then is lamina lucida, then hypergranulosis and epidermal hyperplasia. All of these changes are not specific to knuckle pads, but it is the change which is seen in any hyperkeratotic lesion. Acquired digital fibrokeratoma. Digital means on the fingers, and fibrokeratoma means the lesion has fibrous tissue and keratotic lesions both in combination. It appears as a firm nodule or excrescence less than 1 centimeter on finger or toes. This is a acquired digital fibrokeratoma. Histological appearance is since it's a polypoid or raised growth pedunculated growth, there is thick stratum corneum hyperkeratosis with epidermal hyperplasia and again a fibrovascular core. And small blood vessels. So this is the typical histology. This histology is different from skin tag in that in skin tag, there will not be such a thick layer of hyperkeratosis and neither there will be epidermal hyperplasia. But those these two features are present in acquired digital fibrokeratoma. Fibrous papule of the nose. This is a very benign growth, but important feature of important differential diagnosis of this lesion is basal cell carcinoma. So just because of this differential, it has a little importance that it may usually it present in young individuals, not older individuals. But if such kind of firm swelling is seen in older individual, you would suspect a basal cell carcinoma and you would go for excision. If we do a shave biopsy like this, then the skin epidermis will be stretched again because there is dense fibrous tissue component here. And epidermis is stretched with loss of retinages. And then there is dense collagenous tissue with multi-nucleated cells are apparent. Multi-nucleated giant dendritic cells. These are present usually among the fibrous tissue, dense fibrous tissue proliferation. It's a benign tumor. Nothing to worry about these dendritic multi-nucleated fibroblasts. Then another tumor, which is called as juvenile hyaline fibromatosis. It is a rare autosomal recessive disorder and characterized by a large circumscribed ulcerated mass. A smaller lesion is also present behind this left ear. So a large mass and a small mass. As the name signifies, the stroma will be hyalinized and acellular, comprised of eosinophilic hyalinized collagen-like material. Not collagen, but collagen-like material. This is a hyalinized stroma. Spindle cells are plump. Plump spindle cells in a hyalinized stroma. Again, a benign tube. Then, Palmar fibromatosis or Dupuytren's contracture. You can see this here. This, there is a contracture is visible on this hypothenar eminence. Palmar fibromatosis is seen in associated with trauma, with diabetes, in alcoholic liver disease, in an epilepsy. There is dense eosinophilic connected tissue with uniformly oriented fibers. It is a fibrous tissue proliferation. That's why it's called as fibromatosis. It would be the epidermis and dermis will be normal, but deep down there is dense fibrous tissue proliferation. Sometimes mitosis is also seen. Penile fibromatosis. Or Peyronie's disease. It is solitary or multiple nodules which are close to the corporis cavernosum. And this kind of fibrous tissue proliferation will result in penile deformity. There will be different kind of penile deformities and which may lead to sexual dysfunction. It is associated with type 2 diabetes. If we take the biopsy, if we excise the lesion, which is one of the treatment of penile fibromatosis, you will see dense collagen without significant inflammation. So there will be dense fibrous tissue proliferation and no other specific feature. Treatment is by intralesional interferon alpha 2 injection, intralesional collagenase injection, and even intralesional triamcinolone or canacort injection. Surgery can be done and will result in significant improvement. Dermatofibrosarcoma proteomics. It is important both clinically as well as histologically. You can find the pictures, you can find a patient, you can find a differential diagnosis in which dermatofibrosarcoma protuberance would be there, and even you can get a histopathology slide of dermatofibrosarcoma protuberance. It is typically multinodular. There are multiple group nodules, reddish blue plaque on lower abdomen in a middle-aged female. This is a typical presentation of dermatofibrosarcoma, also called as DFSP, dermatofibrosarcoma protuberance. It is a locally invasive tumor showing fibroblastic differentiation. 4.2 million cases, third to fourth decade female predominance, and cause is due to trauma, burn scar, or radiotherapy. It is a locally invasive tumor. That's why if you don't excise it properly, there are chances of recurrence. Rapid growth, pain, ulceration, and discharge are features. Now the histological appearance. Dermatofibrosarcoma protuberance involves the lower dermis. So upper dermis will be, this is the upper dermis, this is the lower dermis. Here is the demarcation. Upper dermis will be unremarkable, while the lower dermis will be thickened with these spindle-shaped fibroblasts. Another typical feature of dermat DFSP is the epidermis overlying the tumor is of normal appearance. Epidermis is hyperplastic in case of dermatofibroma. But in case of dermatofibrosarcoma protuberance, the epidermis will be of normal size. The upper dermis will also be of a normal shape and size. So this fibrous tissue proliferation will go even deep into the subcutaneous fat in a lace-like pattern. This is a typical appearance which is described of a dermatofibrosarcoma protuberance, which is called as storiform appearance, whirling, whirl appearance, or rush mat appearance. You can see the fascicles of spindle-shaped fibroblast running in different directions. This is a fascicle, this is a fascicle, this is a fascicle. So these fascicles are running in different directions. So this kind of appearance is called as a rush mat or storiform pattern. Mitosis can be seen within this tumor. It is of moderate malignant potential. Adnexal tissues are usually not involved in DFSP. CD34 is the most typical and characteristic stain for DFSP. In addition to that, even EMA will be positive. Other mesenchymal stain like actin and desmin will be negative. So CD34 and EMA will be positive in DFSP. CD34 is not positive in dermatofibroma. Treatment, excise it completely with 2 to 4 centimeter healthy margin. If you don't do this, there are chances of recurrence. And since there are chances of recurrence after excision with 2 centimeter margin, you will also go for post-surgical radiotherapy. The medical treatment is imatinib, a phosphokinase inhibitor, which shows a good response in large, unresectable or metastatic tumors. It's a locally metastatic tumor, okay? Fibrosarcoma. It is clinically, it will be characterized by a firm skin-colored nodule, histologically by basophilia and marked herringbone pattern of spindle cells. Herringbone pattern is just like you can see the bones in a fish. The herring fish, the fish is the herrings is signifies the fish. So the back of bone of the fish usually has a central vertebrae and then the bones which are radiating from it. So in fibrosarcoma will give this herringbone pattern. These are the fibroblasts which are arranged in this typical pattern. Except that there is nothing significant in it. Vimentin positive here, CD34 negative, EMA negative. So if you have some doubt regarding the fibrosarcoma and DFSP, then we can go for vimentin and CD34 stain. Vimentin will be negative in DFSP and CD34 will be negative in fibrosarcoma. Then dermatofibroma, which is again a very common fibrous tissue tumor seen in young and middle-aged individuals, present as erythematous nodules and majority are seen on the limbs. Sometimes pigmentation is seen, which is because of the hemosiderin. Here it is mistaken for a melanoma, a nodular melanoma. The simple excision is usually curative. Dermatofibroma is unencapsulated but compact proliferation of fibrous tissue, histocytes, and blood vessels. It is also called as benign fibrohistocytoma. So the fibrous component and histocytic component are both present in dermatofibroma, which is not present in DFSP. The histocytic component is not present in DFSP. There, it is not encapsulated. The lateral borders are insignificant, and these spindle-shaped fibroblasts, they run between the collagen bundles and dividing the collagen bundles into small fragments. The epidermis overlying the tumor is hyperplastic. There is hyperkeratosis and psoriasiform hyperplasia. There will be a narrow portion of dermis which will be uninvolved. You can say it is in a form of a grand zone. And then the diseased or the pathological dermis starts. This is hyperplasia of the tumor. And it is also going into the fat here. A grand zone type epidermis, which is uninvolved. This is a rounding up of collagen. You can see these round globules of collagen. These globules are formed because of the breakage of individual collagen bundles by these spindle-shaped fibroblasts. This kind of appearance is seen at the periphery of the tumor, which is also one of the typical feature of dermatofibroma, will be differentiating point if you are confused between DFSP and dermatofibroma. So the storiform pattern will be vague. It will not be a true storiform pattern which is seen in DFSP. Multinucleated giant cells, which are fibroblastic giant cells, they are also seen, but does not carry any particular significance. Mitosis is possible, but there will be normal mitosis. It's not a malignant tumor. Sometimes hemosiderin, RBC extravasation and hemosiderin deposition is seen. The brown pigmentation is hemosiderin in this case. Dermatofibroma, two special stains for dermatofibroma are factor 13A and CD68. You know, CD68 stains the histocytes. So So the histocytic component will be stained by CD68, and the fibroblastic component will be stained by factor 13A. Both these two immunohistochemistry stains are not seen in DFSP. Histologically, it's classified as a cellular, aneurysmal, atypical, or epithelioid, depending upon the type of fibroblast. Treatment is with local excision with risk of local recurrence if not excised properly. Giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. The lesion present as a firm nodule that most often affect the finger. Young to middle-aged females, it is locally aggressive and recurrence in up to 30%. This giant cell tumor, the tumor is lobulated. A pseudocapsule is seen surrounding the tumor. The typical feature is the presence of multiple giant cells, which are the fibroblastic giant cell, histocytes, and containing multinucleated giant cells. These are the multinucleated giant cells. That's why it is called a giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. The typical clinical appearance and typical histological appearance is characteristic of giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. These giant cells will be CD68 positive. Atypical fibrosynthoma. Atypical fibrosynthoma is a very interesting tumor because, number one, it arises on a sun-damaged skin in elderly. It is histologically, it is highly malignant, but clinically, it does not behave as bad as it would appear on the basis of histopathology. Tumor present as exophytic nodule, less than 3 centimeters, and present for a long period of time, less than an year. And ear is the characteristic site of fibrosynthoma, but can occur on the scalp as well. The recurrence rate is 5% and they have no metastatic potential. The histological appearance will be a highly pleomorphic intradermal spindle cell tumor. Highly bizarre and pleomorphic. The spindle shape will not be of same, the spindle shape fibroblast will not be of same sizes. They will be of variable sizes with extreme degree of nuclear pleomorphism. Since it is seen in sun exposed areas, there will be solar elastosis at places. This is a very bizarre appearance. You can see the giant cell, you can see the abnormal shape nuclei. Large cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. So look wise, it is highly malignant. Mitoses are seen, these are all abnormal mitosis, abnormal shaped cells. Such kind of tumor would come in the differential diagnosis of all the atypical and bizarre shaped tumors. This is a spindle shaped variety of fibrosynthoma. Okay. In case of atypical fibrosynthoma, we have to differentiate it from sarcomatous squamous cell carcinoma, the main differentials, and leiomyosarcoma, and even spindle-shaped melanoma. So, in case of atypical fibrosynthoma, once you receive such kind of tumor, you will not advise one stain, but a few stains. That is, for example, for squamous cell carcinoma, you will advise EMA, epithelial membrane antigen. For melanoma, S100. For leiomyosarcoma, you will advise smooth muscle actin. Then for atypical fibrosanthoma, the most typical stain is CD10. Features which are not accepted in atypical fibrosanthoma are areas of necrosis and vascular or perineural invasion, because the metastatic potential is zero in case of atypical fibrosanthoma. So if there is vascular invasion, then it would be some other malignant sarcoma. Treatment is limited local removal or rarely Mohs micrographic surgery. If the tumor is present on ear and you want to save the tissue, radiotherapy is usually not indicated. Surgical excision is sufficient. Then, the last part of today's, the last section of today's talk is tumors of muscles. And we will be discussing tumors arising from the smooth muscles of the skin. Pilar leiomyoma. Pilar leiomyoma originates from erector pili muscle, mostly seen in young adults. There are multiple groups, skin-colored or erythematous papules, which are present on the limbs and trunk. They are painful and tender, on pressure and on cold. So leiomyoma also come in the differentials of painful skin tumors. It is L in England. It is usually not solitary. They are usually multiple group and painful papules or nodules. This is familial leiomyoma. Hundreds of lesions may be present. It has an autosomal dominant inheritance. The tumor originates from erector pili muscle and seen within the dermis. An ill-defined tumor. The tumor is comprising of smooth muscles. It originates from smooth muscles. That's why the nuclei of these nuclei here in this tumor will be cigar-shaped or elongated nuclei with blunt edges, not tapering edges like fibroblastic nuclei. Describe a cigar-shaped nuclei. The typical stain for smooth muscle is desmin and smooth muscle actin, SMA or desmin. It will stain the smooth muscles anywhere. Angioleiomyoma. This tumor arises from the muscle component of the blood vessels. And it presents as vascular papule. Usually solitary. This will present as a solitary lesion, not as a group lesion. And almost twice in female as compared to male. And origin is vascular smooth muscle. The typical feature here is a circumscribed tumor, connective tissue tumor with lots of spaces, slit-like spaces, which are lined by endothelial cells. These are the endothelial cells which are lining these blood vessels. Leiomyosarcoma. It is the sarcomatous transformation of leiomyoma. Once the tumor is converting from benign to malignant, it will have its architectural as well as cellular atypia. Now the cells are of bizarre shape. There will be mitosis as well. Extensive pleomorphism is seen. However, no matter how bizarre the cells are, they will be having this immunohistochemistry staining, smooth muscle actin. So that's all for today. We have discussed the connective tissue tumors originating from fat. We have discussed the connective tissue tumors originating from the fibrous tissue. And we have discussed the connective tissue tumors originating from the muscle. Now, next talk, we will be discussing the connective tissue tumors that are originating from nerves and those which are originating from the blood vessels. Any question from today's talk?
जी सर, सर मुझे सर डर्मेटोफाइब्रोमा और डीएफएसपी का डिफरेंस बताइएगा प्लीज।
डर्मेटोफाइब्रोमा और डीएफएसपी के डिफरेंसेस इम्पोर्टेंट हैं, क्योंकि ये दोनों कॉमन ट्यूमर्स हैं जो आपको स्पॉटिंग में भी आ सकते हैं और पूछा भी जा सकता है, इवन शॉर्ट केस भी आ सकता है। पहले तो क्लिनिकली देख लेते हैं ना। क्लिनिकली डर्मेटोफाइब्रोमा प्रेजेंट एज अ सॉलिटरी फर्म नोड्यूल यूजली ऑन द लेग्स इन यंग टू मिडिल एज इंडिविजुअल्स। डीएफएसपी ऑन द अदर हैंड इज सीन इन मिडिल एज फीमेल यूजली ओबीज एंड ऑन एब्डोमेन। Clinically, it would present as multiple grouped papules and nodules with ulceration and suppuration. So, as far as the clinical differential is concerned, I don't think there is any doubt or any problem in diagnosing DFSP and dermatofibrosis. Now, the question comes to histopathology. In histopathology, we'll start from the epidermis. The epidermis in dermatofibroma will be hyperplastic. There will be hyperkeratosis and epidermal hyperplasia just on the top of the dermatofibroma. While in contrary to the dermatofibroma in DFSP, epidermis will be normal. Then beneath the epidermis, there will be a Gren zone type normal dermis in dermatofibroma. Then beneath that normal dermis, you will see the compact fibroblastic proliferation of dermatofibroma. However, in DFSP, almost half of the dermis is unaffected, and other half of the dermis will be affected. Now, the other difference. In dermatofibrosarcoma protuberans, is primarily the cells are fibroblasts, spindle-shaped fibroblasts. And the spindle-shaped fibroblasts will be running in various directions, which is called various directions. The vesicles will be running in various directions. So this will be giving an appearance of
pattern.
This will be giving appearance of a rush mat pattern. It will give a typical appearance of a rush mat pattern. However, this kind of pattern. You can see the vesicles are running in various directions. This is a rush mat pattern. This kind of rush mat pattern is loosely seen in dermatofibroma. It does not mean that you don't see the storiform pattern in dermatofibroma, but it is very loosely seen in dermatofibroma. It's not seen like this. Then another difference is that there is histocytic prominence in dermatofibroma. Histocytes are not seen in DFSP. That is why CD68 will be positive in dermatofibroma and negative in dermatofibrosarcoma protuberans. So the histocytes will be present in dermatofibroma, not in dermatofibrosarcoma protuberans. Rounding up of collagen, which is a phenomena I described at the periphery of dermatofibroma, on both the sides of dermatofibroma, the collagen will be round up like balls, like eosinophilic balls. This is not a feature of DFSP. Then lastly, immunohistochemistry. DFSP will be it will be positive in CD34 and EMA, while in dermatofibroma it will be factor 13A and CD68. 13A will be highlighting the fibroblast and CD68 the histocytes.
Thank you so much, sir.
Any other questions? I have a question. Yes, sir. Sir, can you please tell ye what is plum shape? Sir, ye kis tarah se matlab pata chalegi? Is it spindle shape or something round?
देखो plum क्या होता है? Plum किसको कहते हैं?
Sir, आलू बुखारे को sir.
आलू बुखारे sir thick
आलू बुखारे.
Obese.
नहीं प्लम कहते हैं
आलू बुखारे को कहते हैं
तो आलू बुखारे की शेप का जब कोलेजन फाइबर्स गोल गप्पा हो जाते हैं आलू बुखारे की शक्ल के तो वो प्लम कहलाते हैं मतलब लॉट्स ऑफ साइटोप्लाज्म थोड़ा सा फूल जाएंगे साइटोप्लाज्म भर जाएगा समझ लें पेट बड़ा हो जाएगा उन फाइब्रोब्लास्ट का तो प्लम फाइब्रोब्लास्ट कहलाते हैं
और सर एक और चीज पूछनी थी सारे याद करने
हैं याद अब देखो इस अगर तुमने इस लेक्चर को ले लो तो ये क्या याद है इसमें क्या ऐसी चीजें हैं जो याद कराने वाली हैं मैंने तो आप लोग कोई बड़ी थ्योरियां बताई नहीं क्लिनिकल अपीयरेंस है कोई कुछ की टिपिकल है कुछ की टिपिकल नहीं है इन कनेक्टेड टिश्यू ट्यूमर्स जो मैंने अभी तक आपसे डिस्कस किए कुछ तो ऐसे हैं कि जो सॉफ्ट टिश्यू पेप्यूल और नोड्यूल के साथ प्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं चंद एक के अंदर टेंडरनेस और पेन डिस्क्राइब्ड है चंद एक जो वेस्कुलर ओरिजिन के हैं उसके अंदर ब्लूइश एरिथीमेटस कलर है और बाकी सबकी एक जैसी क्लिनिकल अपीयरेंस है और तकरीबन सबका एक ही जैसा ट्रीटमेंट है और वो एक्सीजन है और ऐसी क्या चीज है जो आपने याद करनी है ये सारी चीजें मतलब जो मैंने आपको अभी आज पढ़ाई हैं अगर यही लेक्चर बार बार पढ़ लें तो मेरे ख्याल है कुछ जरूरत भी नहीं है रुक पढ़ने की और तो कुछ करने की जरूरत नहीं दिस इज ऑल व्हाट इज रिक्वायर्ड फ्रॉम यू कुछ आपको हिस्टोलॉजिकल फीचर्स आने चाहिए कुछ आपको उनका डिफरेंसेस आने चाहिए क्लिनिकली या हिस्टोलॉजिकली आपस में एंड दैट्स ऑल मेरा तो ख्याल है कि अगर आप ये लेक्चर ही बार बार सुन लें और रोक ना भी पड़े तो इट्स मोर देन सफिशिएंट और तो कुछ कनेक्टिव टिश्यू ट्यूमर्स में है नहीं बेसिकली ये जो कनेक्टिव टिश्यू ट्यूमर्स हैं या जो एडिनेक्सल ट्यूमर्स हैं ये बेसिकली हिस्टोपैथोलॉजी है मैंने एडिनेक्सल ट्यूमर के वक्त ये कहा बेसिकली इट इज देयर हिस्टोलॉजी क्लिनिकल अपीयरेंस और ट्रीटमेंट सबके एक जैसे होते तकरीबन विद लिटिल डिफरेंस मैंने अन इम्पॉर्टेंट चीजें नहीं शामिल की इसको ठीक है जी चलें लेट्स क्लोज द सेशन टुडे और उसके बाद फ्राइडे को
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर
ओके जी थैंक यू फॉर